Hello, I'm Fedor. I'm making the game. You heard about it in the rhymes just now. This is a game. This is how it looks. And I'm going to tell how I did it. And what was my original idea? My idea was to create a physics sandbox where a player can play with the, with the physics and move some cubes, throw it, and it's fun just like this. But also, it will be more fun if that sandbox will be network synchronized, if a lot of players will play in the one sandbox and play with the same physics objects. And after that, I realized that I want to give the players ability to create their own game mechanics, because I didn't want to do it myself. And with modding, server owners can build their own games in that world on their servers. And it will be the same game. Before I started, I started to think about this list of things I need to build a game. It was pretty short. It was rendering, physics, animations, and networking. I thought that if I will have that four things, I'll be fine, and the game will be ready. So I started immediately and realized that there is a little more things, like that list. I need UI, visual effects, editors, matchmaking, continuous integrations, assets management, I don't know, a lot of things, very much. So it's a lot of things, and I started to think how I am going to organize them. I came to the idea of entity component system and network synchronization of this entity component system. Now I'm going to tell what is entity component system and how I'm doing it. So entity component system. Imagine you have an object. Every game contains a lot of objects. Imagine one of them, a rabbit. That rabbit have some properties, also called components, like that rabbit have position, fur, alive, IE controllable. And all the properties is just plain structs with plain data, without any behavior, without any motion. And when we need to give an ability to that rabbit to behave somehow, we create so-called systems. Systems is, it's also called processors. It's a piece of behavior that is interested in some kind of properties. For example, IE system is interested in any object that have position and IE controllable both. The main thing here is that IE system doesn't even know that it's a rabbit or it's not rabbit. It doesn't know about the kind of an object. It just works with the data. So with that approach, I can control behavior of objects only with the data. I can, for instance, remove IE controllable and the rabbit will not be controllable by artificial intelligence. And I have a lot of systems. Breath system, when the rabbit is alive, death system, when rabbit is starvation level is too high. A lot of systems. So the first thing I made in Rust was a library for entity component system. It's the first thing, so it's I can't recommend it to anyone. But it still works somehow. I'm going to rewrite it, and I'm waiting for the moment when my desires will not fit to that original library, but it still works, and okay. So this is the example of the simplest system. It's move system. It's interested in any object with both positions and velocity, and on each frame, that system moves object by the velocity. Actually, there is some more arguments, like delta time, so it's moving on each frame, not just by velocity, but by the delta velocity. So more complicated system, and also the result of macro expansion of previous system. It's a bleed zone system. It's some debuff of in the game, like bleeding zone. When you are in some debuff zone, you are constantly losing your health points. Each frame, that system is interested in any object that have both positions, health, and alive. Only alive objects can lose health points. And it gets positions, get health, and if positions is in some area, that lose health. If health drops too low, we remove alive component. Okay, but now we have a problem. That major constant is hard-coded, and when we want to make that zone moving or behave somehow, we need to make it an entity. But we have only one way to set the aspect that we are interested in. So I made something like data aspects. And now that system processing each frame entities with that components, but also its system can read from any entities with bleed debuff and position. So now it's not a 5, it's a bleed zone, the dot x. We can have another system moving any bleed debuff, and it's more more controllable. So next is the scheme of the game. My game is a multiplayer game with a federative server. And basically, all that game is just a huge CRD example, because CRD is everywhere. On the beginning, server loads game data, locations, all the things from a lot of config files. There's a huge part not covered in the presentation, Blender's plugin. It exports a lot of TOML files from Blender scenes with scene data. And on the beginning of the game, server loads the TOMLs and loads it to entity world. And the game starts playing on the server. And on each frame, server first process each server systems. Server system is like any systems with logic, like that bleed zone system or velocity system. Objects start moving. After processing systems, server serialize entire entity world and push it to some dynamic load library. Serialization speed is enough to do it. Actually, it's not enough now, but it will be enough. So that library could process that serialized data and push it back to server. And that library should provide only one function. It's actually not string to string. It's actually some buffer to some buffer, but it's the idea. And I'm going to give an opportunity to make game modes in any language, just given the tools to process that serialized data. And when modding the data is finished, entire entity world, serialized entity world, is sent to client on each frame. So it's the hardest part at the game, because I can't send entire snapshot because it's very big. So it's delta compressed, just compressed, and a lot of hacks to make it. And client just received game snapshots, restore entity world, and run client systems, like representation system, like rendering system, animation system, all the things, and send input back to server. Tricky part here is editor, because I want to edit the game during the game, and I have no local game. I can play only on the server. So editor is just a part of client that can connect directly to server and edit server's data directly. This is how it looks in the game. Oh, well, I'm playing the game, and I can push the button at any moment and launch the editor. And I can for example, create a particle system, move some objects, and check what have I done, and export it, export to some file, and play next. And next, there was an import button in Blender. I can import that div file to Blender, and it will change game data. I can save it to my Blender scenes and use it. I'm actually use it only for some very small tweaks because the editor is very uncompleted. But it works perfectly for some tweaks like change lamp color or some physics parameter like, I don't know, density of object. So next, how I'm doing the serialization. Serialization I'm doing like this. I'm serializing entire entity world, but every component except position. Because position is special component, because every object has position. And I want to make some optimizations to positions. For example, reduce float size for some objects. Reduce, don't send some object that is too far from the player, and such things. While entity system snapshot is just a snapshot of each component in the game. With that approach, delta compressed snapshot is very small because on each frame actually changes only positions. And just normal components is just for game logic that is changing slowly. So it's a long slide, and I will run out of time if I describe it. The idea is that I have entities that can be serialized with SIRD, but not that way and that way. It's complicated, and if I will have time, I will return back, but I think that I will not. So now I'll go to show each big component from the game. And the first is the rendering. I'm using Tamaka's Gloom and simple system like this. It's interested in any object with position and the mesh. It's the object that was received from the server. And some mod data like cameras, lamps, I don't know. There is actually more aspects. And I just draw it to OpenGL. Rendering is very easy now and not complicated. It's just one system. No shadows, no complicated graphics things. Physics. I started with NPhysics. It's the crate from crates.io. It's open source, full Rust. It's awesome for prototyping. It's awesome for hack on it to get into gaming physics at all. I used it a lot, and it was great. But now I'm slowly moving to Bullet 3D. It's a very huge production-ready physics library with tons of features. But it's C++ with complicated C API. Actually, they had old plain C API, and now they're working on physics client sync. It's the way to work with their library through C API, but in complicated way. I'm building Rust binding. It's open source on GitHub. And this is how it looks now. On the bottom, it's Bullet's debugger. And on the top is the game. So I can launch the Bullet's debugger from the server and in real time see the physics and the game both. So it's my renderer, it's Bullet's renderer. This is how looks my Bullet's bindings. It's just bindings on top of Bullet's physics client built for pbullet. It's just connect to bullet server with UI, like on the previous slide, or directly without UI for the server, and create some shapes, change some properties, something like this. Next, UI. UI is one of the most complicated things because I wanted windows like this with fancy effects, and I didn't find any ready-to-use libraries. I wanted to give an opportunity for a UI designer to change the layout or add effects without modifying Rust code. So I picked HTML and JavaScript. So on that slide, there is just a Chromium on top of the game. It works. Actually, everyone using it, even text editors is built in the Chromium. It's crazy for me, but okay. So for embedding Chromium, I used project Osmium. It works, but it's have some problems. The biggest one is that they had the C API in the very old times, in one of the earliest versions. And then they moved to C++ only API. And I wanted to use ready to use C API because it's easy. So it's very ancient Chromium with a lot of problems. But it's quite fast and it's enough for now. But it's really a lot of problems. For example, they didn't have a Windows 64-bits library. It's a proprietary library without 64-bit support for Windows. So I'm using 32 bits on Windows. I'm really lucky that they have 64 bits for Linux, which I use. So this is how it looks. I just create a web view, load HTML, create JavaScript object, set callbacks. It's an example of my lobby where players connect. I just open waiting HTML, create object, and set callback. And later I just execute JavaScript. It's the most unsafe API ever, but but the highest risk that I have that something will not be rendered in UI, and I'm okay with that. If I made something wrong in the JavaScript part, I will just have one small error, and it's really not so important. And actually, I could build something safe on top of it, but okay, next. ImGUI, it's a separate slide just because ImGUI is awesome. I use it for so many things and so much. It's opposite of Osmium. It's supported, it's well, it's safe. It's have a lot of features. It's pure Rust, but it's only for internal tools like profiler, I don't know, color picker, animation graph, some properties. It's really easy to build some Z interfaces, like really easy. Just pick the example from ImGUI and they have all of this. So next, animation. Animation, I built my own animation node editor because I didn't find anything ready to use. I was okay to use some C++, some proprietary, something, anything, that I didn't find anything to use. So I built my own. For animation runtime, I used most of the code from Skeletal Animation Crate. It's awesome. I rewrite entire animation graph logic because I found some idea better than they had. But for runtime, for GPU skinning, it's working awesome. And this is how it looks from the code side. I just have skeletal animation component and from some visual systems from the client, setting some params, raising some events, and don't actually care about how it will look. And later on that graph, I'll set it up. Like, you see, I change speed and player starts to walk. I change, I don't know, rotation, and it rotates, something like this. Next, visual effects. Visual effects, it's just flying planes. Runtime is slow and simple. The complicated part here is editor for okay, nice. Okay. I wanted to show that curve editor. It's built on top of ImgUI, and it helped a lot. By the way, it's the only part of the code that built not by my hands. My friend built entire editor, and it's really cool. Next. Continuous integration. I'm developing from Linux, and my target system is both Linux and Windows. So I have Drone.io instance that builds both Linux and Windows clients, plugging assets for this team, making debug builds. And Drone.io is awesome for Rust. And Rust is awesome for continuous integration, just cargo build. And it's all, and cross compilation is also easier to set up. What do we have time? 5 minutes? 2 minutes? It's the last slide, so I can go back to that serialization slide, but I really don't want to do it because it's more than 2 minutes, and so you can ask me some questions about anything.